UK and Australia listed Leyshon Resources is now undertaking a project which it hopes will ultimately provide gas for the ever-expanding Chinese economy. The managing director and largest shareholder of the company is Paul Atherley, and he joins us now. Paul, welcome.
Hi, Jeremy. How are you?
Very good. Thanks so much indeed. And in fact, you're in a place where there is this expansion going on. I want to talk a little bit more about the Chinese economy in just a minute, but generally speaking, China, you're there, you're undertaking this project. Give us an overview of what you're doing.
Well, we've been there for 7 years, and the remarkable thing is that whilst it's true elements of the Chinese economy, particularly the coastal part of the economy, are slowing, central China, the world's 600 million people, is the world's fastest growing major economy. So despite what you're reading in the Financial Times every day, China's booming. I mean, it's grown from a trillion US dollars 10 years ago to 7 to 8 trillion now. And Jing Urich, JP Morgan in Beijing on the weekend, was saying it's growing at the rate every 3 months, it's growing the size of a small European country.
So you're not worried at all about the figures that are showing the broad number dropping down? Yes, it's still expanding, but you're not concerned at all?
Not at all, because you can't have the world's biggest economy growing at 10%. No. If it's growing at 7 or 8% because it's getting so large, it's still a phenomenal rate. Don't forget, 7 or 8% is still 4 times what the US is, about 10 times the UK, and a completely the opposite direction to most of Europe.
Mm-hmm. So now, China's growing, it needs energy. How are you going to provide that?
It's a very good question, because at the moment, you know, it's producing and consuming 3.9 billion tons of coal. So the default position for China is that it can't do anything else. It will consume more coal, which is not good for the 2050 or even the 2015 carbon targets. They're rolling out nuclear as fast as they can. Renewables are just not going to get there. So the only alternative is gas. And you know that when Obama came to power, the US was an energy importer. And now, at the end of his term, through this shale gas revolution, it's now an energy supplier. China wants to do the same thing.
In the unconventional space?
Very much in the unconventional space. It's quite prolific in the conventional gas space, both domestically and importing. It's just commenced last week a third west-east gas pipeline at $20 billion. And as you know, Hu Jintao and Putin are negotiating the price of the Russian supply. But the problem for that is China then becomes very dependent on imported gas. So it wants to increase the domestic. The only place where there's really big scope for increase is the unconventional space.
Going back to the newspapers here, talking about unconventional, there's all sorts of opposition to it for a number of different reasons. Is there any opposition at all in China?
No, but the same issues are there because there's a political reality that fracking and horizontal drilling and potential impacts on the water table, there's a political reality, there's a question mark. The scientific reality is different. At some point, it has to be brought together so the science can actually outweigh the concerns in the community.
So whereabouts are you in this space? What is Leyshon doing?
We're right at the pointy end, at the exploration end. Someone's got to go and spend some money, sink some wells to find out the gas. And conceptually, to understand where China is vis-a-vis the US, the US has sunk around 10,000 wells in unconventional. China's sunk 60. So it's right at the beginning. So we're right at that pointy end of sinking some wells on the edge of a major basin to go and prove up the first tranche, if you like, of unconventional gas that will go into this major gasification program, which hopefully will transform rural China. You know, we've talked about it, 625 million people, 49% of them are still on the land. That compares with 2% in the US. And China's going to be twice the size of the US economy by 2030. So you're going to say there's 300 million people who are going to move off the land. They're not all going to go to the cities. They can't. The cities can't cope anymore. So you're going to get industrialization in situ, not a reform of the hukou system, reform of the land system. And the gasification program takes power and gas to every city, every town, every village, including schools for central heating, etc.
You don't have gas at the moment. What evidence do you have to suggest that there is gas there in your area?
Right next door at the Sanjiao Bay Linxing project, major discovery. 12 TCS of gas, and ours is absolutely, unashamedly, a neurology story. It's the same geology, same horizons, same targets. It just happens to be 20 kilometers difference between the two. We've done 2D seismic, not 3D, 2D seismic, and there's enough confidence to just simply go and sink some wells.
to the Chinese. You're a foreigner coming in. How are you sort of approaching the project? And who have you got on board that gives you the confidence that you've got the team ready there, set to do what you hope it's going to do?
Really good question. The question fundamentally is, how is it a foreigner can succeed in China? Well, number one, we operate as a Chinese company in China. All our employees are Chinese, and we've just recruited from next door Frank Fu and his team, who drilled that 12 TCF. So the team that did that have now en masse come and joined us. And they like our project, the Zijinshan project. They think it could be even better, but they do everything in the Chinese way. And our partner, of course, is PetroChina, China's super major. And so they bring with it Great Wall Drilling Company that operate in 28 countries, 430 drill rigs, and COSL, China's equivalent to Halliburton. So if you came on the ground in Shanxi province and saw us, we'd be a pure Chinese company.
So what about the processes involved now from here? Where do you go? How are you going to fund it? How are you going to approach that side of the project?
Well, this is the risky bit, because this first program, this $4.7 million, this three wells, is the high risk bit. If we hit gas, we're heroes, we're away. We'll then go and spend another $10 million finding out how much there is. If we don't hit gas, then we've got to go away and scratch our head and say, we've done $5 million, do we go forward? So I would like to say to you that it's binary. That is, we hit gas, we're away. We don't hit gas, we've got to ask our head, have we done $5 million, do we walk away? If we then have hit gas, we spend 10, that tells us how much gas we've got. And then we've got an investment of another 10 to go and appraise that gas, to go and work out whether it's commercial. So if you like, this is a staged $25 million investment that, if we get it right, our consultants are telling us it could be around 3.8 TCF of gas. And the net value to us, net present value, our 60% share after PetroChina have come in at 40%, net to us is about $1 billion US. So it's a staged $25 million investment for $1 billion value.
So when are we going to know?
Well, we're drilling now, Jeremy, and it's quite exciting. We're 500 meters down on a 2.3 kilometer deep well. So the next few weeks, we're indicating to shareholders that around the first couple of weeks in December, we should have some information. So between now and then, it's that is sort of nail biting phase, or as Alex Ferguson would say, squeaky bum time, to find out whether you've actually got any gas or not.
So I would say to you then, as someone perhaps possibly looking at an investment opportunity here, there's the argument to wait, but what would you say is the case for investing now?
Because it's an asymmetric risk. We don't need any money. We have $50 million in cash retained from a gold project that we sold and were profitable before in China. So we're spending five of that 50. So if you like, it's a 10% downside for a multi-bagger upside. So that's that asymmetric risk we're talking about. And of course, the other factor is, it would be incredibly disappointing, Germany, if people didn't want to be in the stock now, and it did hit, and I came back 3 months later, and we're talking, a couple of pounds or something.
Look, we'll keep up with the news, but I'm certainly looking forward to the news about the gas. And in the meantime, Paul, thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much for your time, Drew.
Well, Paul, it's good to talk to you. Paul Atherley is the MD there of Leyshon Resources.